war. There's a whole series of articles here. I guess I'm going to start with the first one here. This is from America Magazine. America Magazine, the Jesuit Review. Of course, we all know we're watching the rise of radical socialism right here in America. And now we've got just more and more with Bernie Sanders, with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who was being promoted by the Jesuits in their America Magazine, even before she was elected. They've got an article here from October of 2018. The headline says, quote, "Yes, democratic socialism is compatible with Catholic social teaching." And of course, right there in this article, they have the picture of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. They're walking across the street and they've got a photo of her. And the article says there is a wave of millennials running for office this fall, and many are running as democratic socialists. The most popular may be Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, the Democratic congressional nominee in New York, whose clarion voice has already made her a national leader. Now, AOC, for those who don't know, is Catholic. She is Catholic. She comes from a Catholic background. If you've not picked up on that yet. In fact, Nancy Pelosi is Catholic. Joe Biden is Catholic. Beto O'Rourke, who says yes, that they are coming to take the AR-15 rifles, the semi-automatic rifles, etc., is a Catholic. O'Rourke, he is a lifelong Roman Catholic. Look it up. Now, obviously, we know that you have conservatives in the Catholic community. We know that. There's no question about it. But are these Catholics who are left-wing radicals, are they being influenced by the Jesuit order, by the Vatican, by Rome? I think it is very, very likely. I don't think it's an accident that they were promoting Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez months before she was actually elected to office, and that she has gotten so much attention from the time that she was elected. And there are even stories out there about her really being an actress who auditioned for the role of being a political candidate and was cast in the part. When you consider, if you go do research into Jesuit theater, the history of Jesuit theater, how the Jesuits, you know, manufactured or created plays and musicals and things like this, dramatizations, which they found to be very, very effective in terms of transforming or changing a social worldview that they wanted to promote, creating theatrics and the use of pageantry and things like this. Rome is known for this for centuries. But the Jesuits in particular have used theatrics and dramatization and things like this. So it could very well be. I mean, if AOC is an actress who was basically prepared to play this role, it wouldn't surprise me if the order was somewhere behind all of this. Remember, Barack Obama, his grassroots campaign organizer was Gregory Galuzzo, who was a former Jesuit. You can go read the online article about Galuzzo and him talking about how when Barack Obama was elected president, it was like having his own son in the White House. Words to that effect. So the issue of the Jesuits, this is not ancient history, folks. This is modern history. This is going on right now. And their agenda with socialism, their agenda with the LGBT movement, their agenda to disarm America. Remember, this same publication had an article years ago calling for the repeal of the Second Amendment. There's no question that they are after that more and more and more. And now you've got Beto O'Rourke coming out saying the one thing that everybody kind of knew, everybody in the conservative community knew, that they ultimately wanted gun confiscation, but the Democrats always denied it. They always said, no, nobody's trying to take your guns, etc. That's a conspiracy theory, supposedly. We just want sensible legislation, etc., etc. And now you've got Beto O'Rourke coming out and very boldly proclaiming that yes, that's exactly what they want to do. But all of this is part of this socialist agenda, because this is what socialism does. And I believe it goes back to the early days of the Counter-Reformation. It's why I did the audio CD on the Saints and the Second Amendment, because if you go back in the history of the 17th century, when you had English Protestants up in Northern Ireland, the English Protestants were first disarmed, and then they were massacred in the Irish Massacre of 1641. And that was one of the events that led to the English Civil War. Then in 1688, you had King James II. He disarmed again now the English Protestants in England. And that was one of the events that sparked the Glorious Revolution. They drove James out of the country and then drafted the English Bill of Rights, which included the right to bear arms. But on both occasions, the Jesuits are said to have been involved both times. They were the ones who instigated the Irish Massacre in 1641, and they were the ones who were instigating James II to disarm the Protestants in 1688. So they know that the right to bear arms was specifically created to oppose them. It is a symbol of a Protestant resistance to the Counter-Reformation, in a sense. And so I don't think that plays any small role in what they're doing and what they're trying to accomplish. And they've done very, very effectively in one country after another after another. Disarm the population and then subject them to some kind of Holocaust or genocide. And we can't just say it's the Jesuits, obviously. There are socialists and communists who probably have nothing directly to do with the Jesuit order. But these philosophies and these ideas can be traced to the order quite directly. All right, now, why am I saying that somehow or other this is all going to end up in a world war? Or why do I believe that? Well, here's another article. This is from Crux Magazine. This is a Catholic publication. And the headline says, Pope to launch global educational pact next year. Now, a global educational pact, and this is what it says. It says, Pope Francis is inviting world leaders and young people to come together at the Vatican on May 14th, 2020, for an event called Reinventing the Global Educational Alliance. The Global Educational Alliance. Just think about that now. Global Educational Alliance. And then it goes on to say, never before has there been such a need to unite our efforts in a broad educational alliance to form mature individuals capable of overcoming division and antagonism and to restore the fabric of relationships for the sake of a more fraternal humanity, Francis wrote, etc. And then the article goes on from there. But basically, what they are planning, apparently, is a global brainwashing and indoctrination system whereby all of these schools, apparently, and colleges and universities are going to be expected to conform to these new ideas. And it will undoubtedly include things like ecumenism, things like the promotion of Islam as something positive, teaching things like Islamophobia, the promotion of homosexuality, LGBT, transgenderism, all of that stuff, okay? The environmental craziness that they are pushing and promoting. In fact, let's just take a moment to talk about that. When the Pope gets together with people and initiates an idea like this, this is not just something that, you know, you brush off like it's not going to be a big deal. It will, sooner or later, it's going to affect things that are happening in our country. Remember when Pope Francis issued his environmental encyclical, Laudato Si, an encyclical on climate and justice. Climate and justice. Pope Francis's encyclical on the environment and human ecology. And now, what are we seeing? We're seeing the Green New Deal. We're seeing all of these politicians promoting this idea, this radical leftist environmentalist ideology. In fact, they've got this girl here, this Greta Thunberg, who's going around giving speeches, and she's the climate girl, the climate change girl, the environmental girl. In fact, she gave a presentation at TEDx. The TEDx talks, which are all about the globalist agenda. The TEDx, they've given presentations, and people should be very concerned about it and paying attention to it because TEDx has been promoting things like pedophilia as a sexual orientation. And that tells you that the globalists are going to be pushing this more and more. This is next on their agenda. But now they've got this girl, this Greta Thunberg. I want to play just a minute or so of her dialogue so you can hear this girl. This is a 15-year-old girl from Stockholm, and she talks about how disturbed she was watching TV and learning about the environment. Let's listen.
I remember thinking that it was very strange that humans, who are an animal species among others, could be capable of changing the Earth's climate. Because if we were, and if it was really happening, we wouldn't be talking about anything else. As soon as you turn on the TV, everything would be about that. Headlines, radio, newspapers. You would never read or hear about anything else. As if there was a world war going on. But no one ever talked about it. If burning fossil fuels was so bad that it threatened our very existence, how could we just continue like before? Why were there no restrictions? Why wasn't it made illegal? To me, that did not add up. It was too unreal. So when I was 11, I became ill. I fell into depression. I stopped talking and I stopped eating. Later on, I was diagnosed with Asperger's syndrome, OCD, and selective mutism. That basically means I only speak when I think it's necessary. And that was one of those moments.
And of course, you got a liberal audience there, ready to
For
applaud
those who are surprised.
and listen to, everything that she has to say. But you have to wonder if she's an 11-year-old girl when apparently she has this very disturbing response to environmentalism. Okay, she's turning on the TV. She's not hearing anything on TV. Nobody's talking about this. Where is she getting the information from? Who's telling her about all this stuff? How did she come to this knowledge that the average person doesn't have? How does she come to this knowledge? Well, she had to be brainwashed and indoctrinated by her parents, who were probably radical leftists, and they're the ones who probably filled her head with all of these ridiculous ideas. And now you got AOC telling everybody the world's going to be destroyed in 12 years. Well, that was about a year ago. So now we're seeing these young people go around saying, well, there's 11 years to the end of the world. What's your plan to do something? As though the world's really going to end in 11 years. All right, we're going to talk more about this when we come back after the break, right after this. Ended ultimately because the climate change and global warming ideology. See, this is not just about protecting the climate. They are mingling in with that, this whole idea of social justice, which is a massive redistribution of wealth program, where they are planning to basically take from one part of society and give to another part of society. I mean, it's just a massive global plundering operation. And more people, thankfully, are waking up to this. In fact, there's a video out there, a satirical video that I thought was very, very clever, where the guy plays the Beatles and he's singing All My Money. And instead of all my money, it's all Bob's money. And he's basically talking, singing to the youth, telling them while there was a bunch of screaming teenage girls in the audience, and he's singing to them, telling them that he's going to give them all Bob's money, somebody else's money, to pay their bills and pay for their education, etc. Here, I want to play just a little bit of it because I thought it was very, very funny, very, very clever. Listen, here it is.
Bob commuted to college for discount and knowledge, so large debts he would not accrue. Lived at home, did some chores, now he'll also pay yours, 'cause I'll give all his money to you.
I already paid off my loans.
All this money.
Now wait just 1 second.
You will get from Bob.
I lived in a basement for 4 years.
All this money, if I get this job.
My school didn't have a rock climbing wall.
All right, so that's the song. Very, very, very funny. You have to go online. I'm not sure who put this together. It's called Caprock Patriot. Caprock Patriot. That's the name that it's given. But it starts out showing a clip of Bernie Sanders promising to pay for everybody's education. And then it goes on from there and breaks into this Beatles song and basically says, you know, all Bob's money I will give to you to pay off your school and your whatever you want. And because that's what socialism is. That's what socialism is. It is simply a plundering operation. Now, the way I understand the development of it, This all began with Jesuit social justice back in 1843. You study Luigi Topporelli. Luigi Topporelli admitted that he took his ideas from Thomas Aquinas. Thomas Aquinas was a Dominican. The Dominicans ran the Inquisition. Thomas Aquinas taught the idea of justifiable theft, that it was okay to steal from someone if you were stealing for a good reason. And of course, the Inquisition did this. The Inquisition would confiscate land and wealth from people because they were accused of heresy. And it was always justifiable to take the land and wealth from a heretic. And now it appears that what happened is through social justice and then ultimately socialism and communism with Karl Marx, and yes, the Jesuits were said to have been working with Karl Marx by leaders like Otto von Bismarck, for example, threw the Jesuits out of Germany because he believed they were working with Marx. But what it appears they did was they took the idea of justifiable theft and repackaged it as redistribution of wealth. And now this is what drives socialism and communism. Also remember that the Dominicans began the Inquisition. They ran it for about 300 years, and then the Jesuits took over from there. But it was a Dominican priest, Gustavo Gutierrez, who was one of the fathers of liberation theology. Liberation theology, which is another form of social justice Marxism. All right, here is another article on a Catholic website. This is from traditionandaction.org, and they've got an article on the new Marxist phase of the Jesuits, apparently not aware that the Jesuits and Marxism go back to the 19th century. But anyway, they quote the Jesuit general, Arturo Sosa. And at one point it says, quote, in 1978, Father Sosa wrote the article, highlighted in red in the first row below, quote, "The Marxist Mediation of the Christian Faith." In it, the Jesuit affirms, quote, "The relationship between the Christian faith and ideologies allows us to admit the legitimacy of a Marxist idealization of the faith. That is to say, it allows us to understand the existence of Christians who simultaneously call themselves Marxists and commit themselves to the transformation of the capitalist society into a socialist society." Then the article goes on. It says, quote, Sosa goes on to conclude that it is necessary to accept Marxism. He says, quote, if this that the various Marxist ideas became part of the patrimony of mankind is a reality on a world scale, then the presence of Marxism is even more important in the Third World, and concretely in Latin America. Our culture is penetrated by Marxist elements. Any understanding of the Latin American process cannot avoid taking into consideration the reality of Marxism as an idea that inspires politics, movements, and actions. Now, who are these immigrants and especially illegal aliens that are being brought en masse into our country? Many of them are from the Latin American world. Many of them are from a very Jesuitical Roman Catholic influence. In fact, you get the book American Democracy and the Vatican by Dr. Stephen Mumford. Dr. Mumford asserts that about 90% of the illegals coming into the country are Catholic, and that this is why the Catholic bishops and the Roman Catholic Church in America is very much in support of illegal immigration. They use all these different arguments and manipulations to further it. Why? Because they ultimately want to use that population to help turn America into a socialist country, which is exactly what we're watching happen. But here, this article traces all the way back to 1978 with Arturo Sosa promoting Marxism and so-called Christianity. Of course, we believe Marxism is completely incompatible with Christianity, that it is an anti-Christian system. But the scripture warns that as time would go on, that evildoers and seducers would wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived, and that false teachers would come promising liberty when they themselves were the servants of corruption. And that, I believe, is what we're seeing happen in the world and in the churches today. All right, brethren, we are out of time. That's going to do it for us today. That is our show. We'll stop it there. But we will be back next time as the Lord leads us. Until then, God bless you and globalism. This is something that we have mentioned on this program on and off because the issue of slavery is constantly brought up in our country. We hear about it in mainstream media. We've got Democrat politicians talking about paying reparations and this kind of thing, and should reparations be paid, and back and forth and back and forth. And it's really remarkable that there is so much rhetoric going on about slavery that was practiced 150 and 200 years ago, and yet there's virtually nothing that is said about modern day slavery in our mainstream media, in our colleges and universities. The fact that Muslims are some of the leading slave owners anywhere in the world, that they openly teach the practice of slavery, as we've talked about at Georgetown University. The Jesuits have a professor there, Jonathan Brown, who's a Muslim, and he's on record for teaching that both slavery and rape are acceptable practices because they were practiced by the Prophet Muhammad. And that turned into a controversy some time ago. They tried to backpedal and make excuses and this kind of thing. But the story, anybody can go look it up. Anybody can go read about that whole event. The guy was speaking, the professor, the Muslim professor at Georgetown, was speaking to an audience, not thinking that anybody was really going to pay attention to what he was saying. And that's what makes it that much more remarkable. Now, of course, once you understand the history of the Jesuits and slavery, the fact that they were big-time supporters of the slave trade, that according to Charles Chiniquy, the 19th century Catholic priest and friend of Abraham Lincoln, the Jesuits played a key role in terms of defending slavery back in the 19th century. And of course, Chiniquy, in his book, 50 Years in the Church of Rome, blamed them for the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. And there is also another book, which if you've not read it, I would highly recommend. It's called Rome's Responsibility for the Assassination of Abraham Lincoln by Thomas Maley Harris, a General Thomas Maley Harris. And he was a member of the U.S. Military Commission that investigated and presided over the trial of the conspirators who were convicted of assassinating President Abraham Lincoln. In other words, he was a 19th century Union general and one of the judges that presided over the trial of the Lincoln conspirators, those who assassinated Lincoln. And he was part of the investigation. And he affirmed much of what Charles Chiniquy said in his writings about all of this, where the Vatican and the Jesuits are concerned. There have been a number of books written about this whole thing. And what I've talked about, I've tried to bring into people's remembrance and understanding about modern globalism. The people who are running the modern globalist movement are all the people, the groups, who were practicing slavery 150 years ago. The Democratic Party, the Muslims, who had been running the slave trade for centuries, and it is reported by historians, a whole variety, a whole cross-section of historians report that the way that the American slavers got their slaves was by purchasing them, not by kidnapping them, but by purchasing them from the Muslim slave traders in Africa. Sometimes from reports that I've read, they purchased them from the African chiefs as well. So you had African chiefs who were not necessarily Muslim, and then you had all of these Muslim slavers that have been there now for 1,400 years. They are still practicing slavery in Africa today. They have millions and millions of slaves in Africa. Modern slavery is far worse than most people realize. If you start looking this up, just go read reports on modern slavery. It is said that there are more slaves in the world today than there were back in 1801 when William Wilberforce began his abolition movement. When the whole abolitionist movement was really moving in the 19th century toward the abolishment of slavery in the Western world. And why? Why is there this dramatic increase? Well, this, according to, here's an article on Forbes, Forbes magazine, that said the 2016 Global Slavery Index, published by the Walk Free Foundation, estimates that 45.8 million people are in some form of slavery in 167 countries. 58% of people in slavery are living in just five countries: India, China, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Uzbekistan. The report estimates that North Korea has the world's highest prevalence of slavery at 4.4% of its population, followed by Uzbekistan, 4%, and Cambodia, 1.6%. There is a website that we've learned about here recently called freetheslaves.net, freetheslaves.net. And you can go and read about the numbers that they have there, where they say there are tens of millions of people trapped in various forms of slavery throughout the world today. Researchers estimate that 40 million are enslaved worldwide, generating $150 billion each year in illicit profits for traffickers. Now, while this is, there's no question that in Africa and the Middle East and India, India is another country, has millions and millions of slaves, even though Western European, Anglo-Saxon, white countries have abolished slavery, and really Great Britain and the United States really led the way to abolish the slave trade in the Western world and then ultimately in all other parts of the world. It's said that slavery is not technically legal anywhere, but that it's still practiced. It's practiced probably more abundantly today than it was 200 years ago. But they call it human trafficking, typically. And one of the key areas of human trafficking is taking girls and children as sex slaves. That's very, very common. And this affects even some of your European countries. In fact, I've talked about on the program before the film that was made years ago called The Whistleblower. It was based on the real life story of an American police officer, a woman named Catherine Bolkovac, who went to work for the United Nations over in Bosnia. And while she was there, here she is thinking she's working for this great humanitarian organization, and she finds out that many of these UN agents were involved in human trafficking. And they were trafficking these teenage girls, forcing them into prostitution, beating them, torturing them, abusing them, and so on. And if they tried to get out of it, they would ultimately have them tortured and killed. And apparently you could not prosecute any of these UN agents because they were given diplomatic immunity. So you couldn't prosecute them for anything, even if you could prove they were guilty. It didn't matter. And so her story, you know, she published this whole account. She went and talked to all these different people about it, and her life was threatened at one point. Ultimately, they turned her story into the film The Whistleblower, and now she's a human rights advocate, and she tells her story and is trying to wake people up to what's going on. Now, if the United Nations is involved in this, the UN has a reach all over the globe. Chances are the estimates that were being given, 40 and 45 million slaves and so on, that could very well be an underestimate. It might be much worse than we know if the United Nations is given this kind of international reach. I believe the UN is an evil organization. It's just evil. And I don't think, you know, I think not only should the United States get out of it, I think that the Christian countries of the earth should band together, get rid of the UN, and form some kind of international alliance of Christian nations somehow. Because it used to be back in the 19th century, you had, for example, the Protestant Mission Society, and you had these Protestant groups from all over the world that came together, and they were empowered by the British Empire and then also by the United States. And so they were able to accomplish a tremendous amount of good and put a stop to slavery in many parts of the world because Great Britain and the U.S. back then were not ashamed to be Christian countries. But in the aftermath of World War I, World War II, and then you got this whole postmodern movement, you got biblical skepticism that was normalized in the colleges, schools, and universities. So people no longer believe that the Bible is the Word of God in many cases. And so with that now, why should the Christian standard be the absolute standard? That's been the argument. And because the authority of the Bible and God's law and Christianity has been undermined over the last 100 years, there's no real reason not to practice slavery, quite frankly, because it was always Christianity that stood for freedom. It was always God's law that was the law that was employed. God's law that says if you kidnap somebody and enslave them, you are to be put to death. And that is from Exodus chapter 21 and verse 16. Exodus 21:16. Says, and he that stealeth a man and selleth him, or if he be found in his hand, he shall surely be put to death. You see, God pronounces the death penalty for kidnapping and enslavement. So much of the slave trade, now you had the whole business of indentured servitude, which was a different matter. People are working on behalf of paying off debt. You also have enslavement for people who commit a crime. That was another form of punishment. But to steal a man, to take a man for no reason, and that would be a man or a woman, obviously, to take somebody, to steal them, kidnap them for no reason, and then to sell them as a slave, or to keep them as your own slave, because God's law takes both into account. The death penalty is the punishment. Now, if God's law were being upheld and enforced by the Christian countries of the world, my suspicion is that human trafficking would drop, would fall dramatically. If every time these guys, because they'll often, I mean, the stories are unbelievable of girls who are basically kidnapped by men and then forced into prostitution. They're forced into sex slavery. And if they're trying to get out of it, they are severely beaten by their pimps in a very brutal, brutal manner. Some of the stories are just heartbreaking of what happens to these poor girls. In fact, there is a film that I've learned about recently that I recommend for people who want to learn more about this, a film that was apparently made by a Christian film company. The film is called Nefarious Merchant of Souls. Nefarious Merchant of Souls. All right, let's go to our commercial break, and we will talk more when we come back. Slavery, you know, as I said at the top of the program, if you look at the groups, the primary groups, the Democratic Party, the Muslims, who are working together, there's no question. The European elitists, those who have adopted socialism. Where does socialism come from? You can trace it directly to the Jesuits working with Karl Marx in the 19th century, basically to Rome, to the Vatican. The Vatican was the one world power that officially recognized the Southern Confederacy during the American Civil War. In other words, the Vatican supported the slave trade against the concept of freedom. The Vatican opposed Abraham Lincoln. And so you had people like Charles Chiniquy, who was the friend of Lincoln. He asserted that ultimately the Vatican and her Jesuits were responsible for the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. And there were others like General Harris who agreed. In the 20th century, you had another Catholic priest, Emmett McLaughlin, who wrote a book on the investigation into the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. He was a Catholic priest. He had converted to Protestantism, but he wrote his book, and he believed that Chiniquy was correct. We've had a book that we've carried on and off for several years called Who Killed Abraham Lincoln by Canadian author and researcher Paul Serup. And he spent some 20-odd years investigating the claims of Chiniquy and came to the conclusion that, yes, Chiniquy was correct. In fact, most of the authors that I've seen from the 19th and early 20th century and forward, when they actually take the time to investigate Chiniquy's assertion, they come to the conclusion that, yes, Chiniquy was right. But the question is, has the Vatican and have the Jesuits repented of their view of slavery? The Jesuits in modern Georgetown University, because they took this vote some time ago to have their students pay a fee every semester that they're then giving as a reparation to some group that is supposedly the descendant of slaves. But the whole thing is really kind of a farce, because the Jesuits are not paying some reparation. They're having the parents of these students basically pay the reparation. And meanwhile, they've got their Muslim professor there who's teaching that slavery is acceptable, and the Jesuits are taking millions of dollars from at least two countries that still practice modern-day slavery. In fact, there was an article on this from the Daily Caller. The Daily Caller published an article that said, here's the headline, Georgetown apologized nonstop over slavery. School still took money from slavery rampant country. Then it says, Georgetown University has tried to atone for the school's history with slavery, because it's well known the Jesuits practiced slavery, and they sold their slaves and made money from their slaves to support Georgetown University. That's why this is an issue for them. So it says that they tried to atone for the school's history with slavery by apologizing, implementing affirmative active policies, and renaming buildings. The school, however, accepted nearly $333 million in funding from Qatar between 2011 and 2016. Now, of course, Qatar is a Muslim country. They've also taken at least $20 million and probably more from Saudi Arabia at Georgetown University. So, and Saudi Arabia is well known. Nobody talks about it in the mainstream, but it's been reported for years that Saudi Arabia still practices slavery. They officially abolished it back in the 1960s, but nobody, at least based on the stories that I've seen, nobody thinks they actually gave it up. Why would they? Because the Prophet Muhammad was a slave owner. The Quran, the Hadiths, Islamic tradition and history and so on all support the practice of slavery. The only reason they technically gave it up was because they were pressured by Great Britain and the United States. That's reportedly the only reason they gave it up. But it is still said that they are buying and selling slaves in Saudi Arabia to this day. So here you've got the Jesuits pretending that they're sorry for slavery, pretending that they're trying to do something, pretending that they're paying some reparation when they're not really paying a reparation. And meanwhile, they're promoting Islam through the Bridge Initiative there, which is their program of brainwashing everybody with propaganda about so-called Islamophobia, that this is the great danger in America today, Islamophobia. Muslims are endangered because of Islamophobia. Never mind the fact that Muslims are killing people every day virtually in the name of Islamic Jihad. You can go to the website, thereligionofpeace.com, and read their weekly and monthly jihad reports and all the killings that are taking place every week, every month, and so on, all in the name of Islamic Jihad. And yet we've got these people who are telling us that if you are concerned about that, then you have some kind of irrational phobia. And the Jesuits have institutionalized the whole idea of Islamophobia. And as we've said before, Islamophobia is the doorway to Sharia law. Always remember that. Brothers and sisters, always remember, anybody who talks about Islamophobia is trying to advance Sharia law in the United States. That's what they're trying to do. Because Sharia is the solution for Islamophobia. So they have to create the problem. Then the solution is to advance Sharia. Let's get back to our discussion on slavery here. I wanted to read this quote from Patrick Henry. Patrick Henry said, quote, "Bad men cannot make good citizens. It is impossible that a nation of infidels or idolaters should be a nation of free men." We need to remember that. We need to reclaim that in our country. It is impossible that a nation of infidels, that is non-Christians, or idolaters, people who are worshiping these false gods, should be a nation of free men. It is when a people forget God that tyrants forge their chains. And then he goes on from there. It was understood by our forefathers that Christianity is the religion of liberty. The Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Jesus said, if the Son of God shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. Paul says, Galatians 5:1, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again in the yoke of bondage or slavery. You go to Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1. This was a verse that Jesus quoted toward the very beginning of his ministry. But Isaiah 61:1 says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. The opening of the prison to them that are bound. And then verse 2, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. And we have to wonder, as we watch what these globalists are doing at a variety of levels, are they trying to bring back the slave trade? And is that why they're promoting Islam, and they want Islam to flood into all these Western countries, because they know that the Muslims really have no problem with slavery? And they want that Islamic mentality to be taught more and more in our schools, colleges, universities, etc., which could be why they've got this guy at Georgetown who's teaching this. Is that their long-term goal in the West, to re-normalize and bring back the practice of slavery? Well, God forbid it should happen here in America, but we need to be aware of what's going on and not be ignorant of the enemy's wiles. Christianity has fought for 2,000 years against slavery in a variety of ways, both spiritually and literally. So I believe this is something we need to be aware of, we need to be in prayer about, and seek the Lord for what we can do to oppose these things in our day. All right, brethren, we are out of time. That's going to do it for us today. That's our show. We will stop it there. Going on right now, the world here in America is just becoming more and more intense as the advance of the progressive agenda just moves forward more and more every day. Now we're watching the debates. I mean, I'm not watching them fully. I'm watching bits and pieces of them, the Democratic debates of these Democrat candidates who are so far off to the left. I mean, they are just beyond anything that you would have imagined even 4 years ago. Even 4 years ago. They are so far to the left, and they've gone completely out of the country. They're not even representing ideas that have anything to do with America, the United States, our Constitution, any of it. They are going for broke, full-blown radical leftism, full-blown assault on the free world, and I think with a target on the back of Christianity in particular. That is what they want to assail. You have the repeated attempts. I mean, I'm sitting here watching in disbelief these debates that are happening, even on Fox. I'm watching debates. They're debating about this guy, Pete Buttigieg, Mayor Pete, they call him, or Saint Pete, they call him, because he's always lecturing people about morality. And he's claiming that he's running some kind of Christian campaign, that he's representing a Christian cause. And the guy is an out and proud homosexual who is, you know, who appears with his male partner that he calls his husband. And this whole thing is like an episode of The Twilight Zone. And he's going around preaching to everybody now, defending abortion. And that people who are calling themselves Christians, but who are not supporting abortion rights and this kind of thing, well, there will be a reckoning for them one day and this kind of thing. It's psychological warfare, I believe. I don't believe all of this is accidental. I think this has been engineered because it is so far off. It is so perverse. It's so crazy. But the worst part of it is that the LGBT movement in particular is infiltrating your mainline churches. Your Baptists more and more are completely giving in to the idea of gay rights. I mean, Mass Resistance Now, which is a pro-family activist group that confronts the whole gay movement, they had an article last year. Mass Resistance Texas activists continue to fight to stop LGBT infiltration into Southern Baptist denomination. And that situation, as many of you already know, is getting worse and worse. In fact, here you've got a recent article that you can find on ChristianHeadlines.com. Baptist Church Makes History, Calls Transgender Pastor. Calls Transgender Pastor. An Ohio Baptist church this summer called a transgender pastor to lead its church, making it one of the few Baptist congregations in the United States to be led by a minister who has a gender identity different from their birth sex. Peace Community Church called Erica Saunders, a graduate of Wake Forest University School of Divinity, and then held an official welcoming service this month for Saunders, according to Baptist News Global. The congregation was founded as First Baptist Church of Oberlin in July 1866, and then it goes on from there. So now they have a transgender. They basically have a man who is dressed up like a woman, practicing transgenderism, and they're calling this person a pastor here over a Baptist church. You know, some people think this is progress. They think this is a progressive movement, and what's happening now is society is moving forward. We're somehow or other learning things that we don't know or that we did not know. And what we're going to talk about, we're going to go over transgenderism in the Bible. We're going to go over transgenderism in the Bible. But before we do, I want to go over this. I just found this article on charismanews.com. The California Senate passes resolution telling pastors to embrace LGBT beliefs. California Senate. Now, this would be part of the reason why my wife and I got out of California back in 2007. We had lived out there, had been out there for close to 10 years, and then we had our two oldest daughters and just saw the direction that the state was headed where things like this are concerned, and we simply did not want to raise them up in that part of the country. And so we came to Tennessee, and thankfully things are not nearly this bad in the state of Tennessee. But back to this article, just to read part of what they're saying here. It says, quote, California Senate passed a resolution telling Christian clergy to accept and support LGBTQ ideology, even if doing so violates their Christian beliefs. Assembly Concurrent Resolution 99, also called ACR 99, was introduced by Democratic State Assemblyman Evan Lowe of San Jose on June 4th as a way to gather support for LGBTQ identity and behaviors. Now, obviously, these kind of declarations are a complete departure from the Constitution. I mean, they're obviously a violation of the laws of God, but the modern lawyers, judges, politicians, the modern political system in America, the post-World War II, post-1960s and 70s especially, political establishment in the United States has abandoned the original precepts of our Constitution. We're going to be talking about that in our upcoming film on the true Christian history of America, because the very foundation of all law is the law of God. That's what our forefathers believed, and that's really what's written into the Declaration of Independence. Many people don't realize that, but yes, that's what's meant by the phrase, the laws of nature and of nature's God. But that's all been abandoned now because they've reinterpreted it, they've rewritten the history books, they're changing everything. And so concepts like freedom and equality have been utterly perverted at this point, and this is... You know, so what happens as a result? Things like freedom of religion, freedom of conscience, freedom of speech, all of these things are being eroded and will ultimately be destroyed if this continues. All right, so now let's talk about this from a biblical perspective, a biblical worldview. Let's talk about the transgender issue here. They're putting a transgender pastor into a church, what they're calling a church. What does the Word of God say? Deuteronomy chapter 22 and verse 5 says, "The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do so are abomination unto the Lord thy God." So just like God calls homosexual practices an abomination, he also condemns, in Deuteronomy, the practice of a man dressing up like a woman is also called abomination unto the Lord thy God. Now, if you go to 2 Kings chapter 23, 2 Kings chapter 23, Deuteronomy 22, this would have been one of the things that would have been shown to the ancient King Josiah. King Josiah, who was crowned king when he was just a child. Then he grew up, he began to seek the Lord, and then one day men recovered the book of Moses, a book of the law of Moses, from within the temple. And apparently it had fallen into disuse, that they had been practicing variant forms of idolatry for many years, and Josiah was not aware of God's true law and his commands. And so they bring the book of Moses into the presence of the king, and they read to him all the words of the book of God's law. And when Josiah hears it, he tears his garment, he weeps, he falls on the ground. He realizes that his kingdom has gone far away from the will of God. And now he's going to lead a reform, and he leads a mighty reform through that time. So what does he do? What does he do? Well, he would have read Deuteronomy chapter 22. And so we get to 2 Kings chapter 23. And we'll start in verse 6. This is when Josiah is leading the reform. It says, "And he brought out the grove from the house of the Lord." Now, the grove can mean one of two things. A grove of trees where they would have an idol in the grove of trees, or it could be a particular tree that was carved into the image of a god or a goddess. They called it an Asherah. And so sometimes when you see the word grove, it's a reference to the Asherah pole. And so it was basically an idol carved out of wood, out of a tree. So it says, "And he brought out the grove from the house of the Lord without Jerusalem unto the brook Kidron, and burned it at the brook Kidron, and stamped it small to powder, and cast the powder thereof upon the graves of the children of the people." Verse 7, "And he brake down the houses of the Sodomites, where the women wove hangings for the grove. And he brought all the priests out of the cities of Judah, and defiled the high places where the priests had burned incense from Geba to Beersheba," etc. Okay? So basically, Josiah is destroying all of the idols and the idolatry and so on, and he's confronting these priests. And notice, part of what he does, he tears down the houses of the Sodomites that were built up along the walls of the temple in Jerusalem, that were by the house of the Lord. That's what it says. "Break down the houses of the Sodomites that were by the house of the Lord." So here we see Sodomites trying to infiltrate the ancient Jewish church, if you will, the temple there, the house of the Lord, just as we see Sodomites infiltrating churches in America and different parts of the world even today. But who were these Sodomites? We're going to read a commentary when we come back from the break, and you're going to see that these particular Sodomites, according to church historians, these particular Sodomites were a transgender cult called the Gali. The ancient Gali, they were a transgender cult. And so transgenderism, as we're going to learn, this is not some new idea. This is not some progress that humanity is making. On the contrary, folks, we are being taken in a retrograde manner, meaning reversing the progress of civilization that had always been driven by and defined by Christianity through the Word of God. All right, let's go to our commercial break, and we will talk more when we come back. This whole LGBT movement that we've been zeroing in on, because it's in the news. There's a number of stories. In fact, for people who are not following, I mean, yes, we see the infiltration in the churches. There is also a move in the schools. Right now, if you go type in how in our school systems, more and more, the idea of pedophilia as a sexual orientation, calling it a sexual orientation, that is being promoted more and more and more in schools and colleges and universities. Now, this is where Christians and conservatives have to pay attention to what can only be called a very uncomfortable subject matter. And I know because this was very uncomfortable to research years ago when I worked on our film, The Kinsey Syndrome, which anybody can go online and watch. You can go to YouTube and you can watch it. You can watch it for free. You can get a copy from us. You can watch it for free. You need to know what is in that film, and you need to know where this whole thing is headed. Where they are headed, folks, just like they are coming up with punishments for Christians and anybody who resists these concepts of sexual orientation, they are going to do the same thing. They're going to try to do the same thing where pedophilia is concerned. But what they need is an official declaration through the courts that pedophilia is a sexual orientation. They're already teaching that it is. They've been teaching that for decades. Many people don't realize. They were teaching it and they would deny it. We went, as we show you in the Kinsey Syndrome, we actually went to one of the headquarters for all of this garbage and perversion, the Institute for the Advanced Study of Human Sexuality in San Francisco, and we confronted them and we asked them specifically about their views on pedophilia. And they denied anything and they told us to get out and they wouldn't talk about it. So, but that was back then. That was like back in 2004, five, right around there. So they didn't want to talk about it back then. Now, of course, they're being more and more open. They're revealing more and more. But it's important to recognize that much of this culture is a rape culture. That is what they are. Here's a story that has been recently featured in the New York Times. The headline says, quote, six men tell their stories of sexual assault in the military. Sexual assault in the military. And then it goes on to say more than 100,000 men have been sexually assaulted in the military. Now, we've talked about this before. Why? Because Bill Clinton brought the gays in under Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Then when Obama got in there, he overturned Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And now they're letting the homosexuals and the transgenders run wild. And what are they doing? They are systematically raping our young men in the military. You have to understand, I've read some of these stories. They're very disturbing. I don't even like to quote them because they're so vile. But in the military, you are taught to obey rank and your superiors. You know, we were a military family. We were in for 23 years, or my dad was in 23 years, and I grew up on military bases. And my mother used to say, she said, son, the army defends a democracy, but it is not a democracy. In the army, you follow orders. That's what you do. So it puts men in a very compromised position. And when you have the homosexuals that are, they become base commanders, they become high-ranking officers, etc. When this kind of activity goes on, it increases the likelihood that those in charge, that those in command, will very likely cover it up. All right, so let's go back to this passage here in 2 Kings 23 and verse 7, where we're reading about King Josiah breaking down the houses of the Sodomites. Who were these Sodomites? This is according to the pulpit commentary. The pulpit commentary, where it mentions the Sodomites, it says, quote, literally of the consecrated ones. And note that the male prostitutes or galli who consecrated themselves formed an essential element in the Astarte worship. So what they did was, this was a transgender cult that worshiped a goddess, the goddess Astarte from the ancient world. And it goes on, it says, Dollinger says of these wretched persons, quote, to the exciting din of drums, flutes, and inspired songs, the galli cut themselves on the arms, and the effect of this act and of the music accompanying it was so strong upon mere spectators that all their bodily and mental powers were thrown into a tumult of excitement, and they too, seized by the desire to lacerate themselves, deprive themselves of their manhood by means of potsherds lying ready for the purpose. Thereupon they ran with the mutilated part through the city, and received from the houses which they threw them into a woman's gear. Not chastity, but barrenness was intended by the mutilation. In this, the galley only desired to be like their goddess. So in other words, what they did was they had this ceremony. They get all hyped up. Then they take a potsherd, a sharpened instrument, and then they would castrate themselves, cut off their male member, go throw it into these different houses, and then it was apparently part of the custom, if a member came flying in your window, then you had to go out and hand them a woman's garment. And then they would put on the woman's garment, symbolizing that they've now been transformed and they are like their goddess. So this is the cult that King Josiah drove out and broke down their houses that were near the house of the Lord, or that were by the house of the Lord, it says. And it says, here's the commentary, the pulpit commentary. It says, the near vicinity is an indication that the Galilee took part in the foreign rites introduced into the temple by Manasseh and Amon. The awful profanation of the house of God by such orgies is too terrible to dwell on. And there's no question about that. Too terrible, too hideous to think about what they were involved in. But this is what we're seeing. We are seeing a return of this kind of ancient, abominable, pagan behavior. And just as they went after the house of the Lord thousands of years ago, that is what the homosexuals and the transgenders, the modern sodomites, are doing in our country today. That's what they're doing. They have set their sights on pursuing the house of God, and it is their desire to profane it to the uttermost. Now, of course, I think we as Christians have a responsibility to resist them to the uttermost, to oppose them to the uttermost, and to resist this ungodly, evil, immoral, unconstitutional government that is trying to advance this wickedness in the United States of America. They have absolutely no constitutional authority to do so. They might force themselves on people, but they're not doing it according to the rule of law, not any real laws that we have in our country. Fake laws, yes, they come up with their fake laws. But these are not real laws, according to all of the teachings of the people who founded this great country, who founded our republic, who created our founding documents. They would all say gay law is not law. It's anti-law because it's against the laws of God. That's what we've got to remember. Okay, brethren, we are out of time. That's going to do it for us today. That is our show. We have some exciting audio to play here on the show today, which when I saw it and I heard it, I'd heard about this for years, but I'd never actually seen a video clip like this from a documentary featuring, of all people, Leonard Nimoy. Leonard Nimoy, who is one of the great documentary narrators and presenters, I think, in the history of the 20th century. He's like the perfect guy when giving a presentation or a documentary. He's got a great voice, great presence. Of course, he was Mr. Spock on Star Trek. And for those of us who remember watching the show back in the 1970s, Leonard Nimoy, always a very, very special character, a special person. But we're going to play a clip here on the show from the History Channel all the way back in 1979, and what they were saying about environmentalism and what the direction was going to be for the environment in the years ahead. And you're going to hear some of the climate alarmism from that time, and we're going to talk about how it has changed. Very quickly, I wanted to play play this clip. Many of you have probably heard it, but just to remind ourselves of what's been going on with Greta Thunberg and her entertainment parents. She's got a father who's an actor, a mother who's a singer, and it would appear that they coached her in terms of giving her speeches here on environmentalism. But here's a quick clip just to remind ourselves. Listen.
This is all wrong. I shouldn't be up here. I should be back in school on the other side of the ocean. Yet you all come to us young people for hope. How dare you? You have stolen my dreams and my childhood with your empty words. And yet I'm one of the lucky ones. People are suffering. People are dying. Entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction, and all you can talk about is money and fairy tales of eternal economic growth. How dare you?
Okay, and then the applause, of course. Now, we should say, it's very important to say that this young girl, Greta Thunberg, is really, she is being misused. She's really being abused, I think, by her parents and the people in her life, the adults, the older people who have conditioned her to think this way. She is, in a sense, I think she's really a victim, because she gets very emotional when she's giving these speeches, but the speeches are written out for her. There's another video clip that surfaced of her and other young people that they put on a panel. All of these young kids, really, talking about the climate and what about our future and our future is going to be ruined and all this kind of thing. And one of them asked Greta Thunberg a question that she didn't have a script for. And she went quiet. She started to say a couple of things, but simply did not have anything to say. And it seems clear that she has been conditioned, whether by her parents. I find it very interesting that her father is an actor, and it's very possible that he's coached her, given her acting lessons, and, you know, written out her speeches for her, or somebody else has. And then, you know, they've coached her on how to communicate this and get emotional and this kind of thing, because that seems to be what she's doing. But when she has to talk about this on her own, off script, she's not so well able to do so. And she's obviously being used by these globalists for this agenda. Now what I want to play is I want to play this clip from the History Channel, a presentation that they did all the way back in 1979 when they were promoting an Ice Age scare. And this clip is just over a minute long. I want you to listen. Listen to what Leonard Nimoy is saying, and how completely different it is back in 1979 versus what we are being told today. Listen.
The data shows that average temperatures in the Arctic have fallen dramatically over the last 30 years. In most locations, the drop has been about 2 degrees centigrade. At that rate, the descent to ice age temperatures could take less than 200 years. It is not only the lonely Arctic that is cool. The whole northern hemisphere is growing steadily colder.
There is little doubt that someday the ice will return. At least 8 times in the past million years, it has advanced and retreated with clockwork regularity. If we are unprepared for the next advance, the result could be hunger and death on a scale unprecedented in all of history. Scientists are telling us now is that the threat of an ice age is not as remote as they once thought. During the lifetime of our grandchildren, Arctic cold and perpetual snow could turn most of the inhabitable portions of our planet into a polar desert.
Okay, and it cuts off right there at the end, but what he says is could turn parts of our planet into a polar desert. That's what he's saying. But you can hear what he's saying. He's saying in the lives of our grandchildren. He's saying, we're about to enter into a new ice age, the global cooling. We're going into an ice age. Now, this is 1979. By the time you get by 1988, The New York Times published an article in which they said, quote, global warming has begun. So from 1979 to 1988, just 9 years, they went from where about the scientists are telling us now. In 1979, the scientists are saying that we're about to enter into a new ice age. And by 1988, they'd flipped it around. Now it's global warming. But they're not telling all of this to the kids in school. They're not going to show the kids in the high schools and in the regular schools this video clip of Leonard Nimoy back in 1979 predicting the new ice age, and that the scientists are saying the ice is coming, and this kind of there. And then to say, well, then they flipped it around and now they've completely changed their mind. And obviously that calls the credibility of their capability to foretell these things and to accurately discern what's going on. That calls all of that into question. But see, they don't want to be called into question. So now they're trying to come up with ways to fashion laws, or at least they're talking about it, to find ways to punish climate change deniers, and this kind of thing. And they're getting Hollywood involved. In fact, Harrison Ford is on some environmental committee, and he just gave a speech here recently and talking about how these young people that are coming forward, that the thing we need to do is to get out of their way and let them go and be the ones to solve this problem for the next generation. But the inconsistencies of it are not being discussed. They're being brushed aside. And what is the global warming thing? Just if you haven't figured this out, for anybody who might be hearing this program and you haven't really looked into it, global warming is simply a totalitarian power grab. It is an attempt by these globalist powers to try and seize the wealth and the politics of the planet, they hope, because they're creating this alarm, this problem, the problem and solution. So you have to create a problem. The problem is, well, the whole world's going to be destroyed in 10 or 12 years. If something's not done, we need an emergency plan. To do what? Well, to seize wealth and control of people's lives. We have to control what you're eating, whether or not you drive a car, whether or not you fly a plane, whether or not you are able to do anything. We have to control every aspect of your life so that we can save the environment. And that's what the Green New Deal is about. The Green New Deal is simply a totalitarian power grab. And if you study the Green New Deal, they go from environmentalism into social justice issues, where they argue that, well, all of this pertains to somehow the fact that they need a big, massive redistribution of wealth program. That's also got to be done. And of course, the people who are promoting this are notoriously hypocritical. There's a story here on Fox News about Leonardo DiCaprio slamming the climate change deniers. And the subtitle says, quote, stars attend climate change summit in private jets and yachts. They flew all these private jets and yachts, apparently, to come to some climate change summit. So they're doing exactly what they say we need to stop doing. People just shouldn't be burning up all this fuel and emitting carbon, all this other kind of stuff. And yet they're the worst offenders. Something's got to be done by, you know, people need to be making sacrifices, just not them. That's the problem with it. It is an elitist power grab. They want to control the lives of the little people, but they have no intention of changing their own behavior. They want everybody else in the bread line, but they're not going to go stand in the bread line. They want to be the elitist, the upper class, that doesn't have to deal with all of that. You have Prince Harry and his wife, Meghan Markle, the Duchess of Sussex. They are liberals and environmentalists and so on, and they're into this whole thing. And you got a story here at Breitbart News that says Harry and Meghan used a fleet of vehicles specially shipped from the UK to Africa to go there and talk about climate change. And the story says, quote, Prince Harry and the Duchess of Sussex, Meghan Markle, used a special fleet of Range Rovers shipped from the UK to carry them and their traveling Scotland Yard police escorts on their current 10-day trip to South Africa. The Times reports the special 4x4s were drafted in for the climate campaigners because organizers behind the royal visit were unable to locally obtain cars suitable for Harry, Meghan, and baby Archie. Now, of course, the energy involved with this, environmentally speaking, is incredibly wasteful to be doing this kind of thing. And their use of private jets. This is because, why? Because they're big-time environmentalists. That's why. Prince Harry said at one point, concerning all of his private jetting around with his wife, he said, quote, I have always offset my CO2. I think part of the group discussion that we had earlier is, what is offsetting CO2? Then it says, the past 2 months have been busy for the royal pair, with them spotted at one stage taking 4 private jet flights in just 11 days. And they're not politicians. It's not like they're signing treaties and doing something like that. They're just going and visiting people. It's not especially necessary for them to take these trips. Not at all. And they could certainly take other modes of transportation. You know, the celebrities could all decide they're all going to take one plane together, but they're not doing things like that. They're not doing the things that they think everybody else needs to do, but they want everyone to believe that there is this global emergency and everybody's got to get on board right now or else. It is a power grab. That's what it is. And I think that's why, you know, part of me thinks that these celebrities, it's hard to say who knows and who doesn't know who's in on it. But it's hard to believe that they really believe this stuff based upon how they live their lives. Sorry. Let's go to our commercial break. We will talk more when we come back right after this. What is that? 20, 40, right about 40 years ago. It was going to be global cooling and a new ice age. And within a short time, it became global warming. And now, supposedly, the world is going to end within the next 10 years, according to AOC and others, if something dramatic is not done. Here in a minute, we are going to talk about an article. There's an article titled, 18 Spectacularly Wrong Predictions Made around the time of the first Earth Day in 1970. We're going to go over some of these predictions. But first, what I want to do is to play some audio from Leonardo DiCaprio. He's one of the big environmentalists in Hollywood. And listen to some of what he's saying. It's this kind of thing that has really convicted people like Greta Thunberg and many other young people who don't know any better about what's really going on. Listen. And listen to how they introduce Leonardo DiCaprio at the United Nations.
Please welcome newly appointed United Nations Messenger of Peace, Mr. Leonardo DiCaprio.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary General, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished guests. I'm honored to be here today. I stand before you not as an expert, but as a concerned citizen, one of the 400,000 people who marched in the streets of New York on Sunday, and the billions of others around the world who want to solve our climate crisis. Every week we're seeing new and undeniable climate events, evidence that accelerated climate change is here right now. Droughts are intensifying, our oceans are acidifying, with methane plumes rising up from the ocean floor. We are seeing extreme weather events and the West Antarctic and Greenland ice sheets melting at unprecedented rates, decades ahead of scientific projections. None of this is rhetoric, and none of it is hysteria. It is fact.
All right, so notice it's not just rhetoric. He says this is fact. And this is part of what, you know, when I did my research for the Kinsey Syndrome years ago, the phrase that comes up again and again and again with Kinsey's research is the concept of junk science. That's what they call Kinsey's research. Junk science, that they use fake scientific data to try and convince people of things and get them to go along with some agenda, whatever it is. I mean, this is what Darwinism is all about. Darwinism is all based upon fake, a fake analysis, or really a corrupt analysis of scientific data. And at some points they've used fakery like the Piltdown Man and so on. I believe that's what's behind the critical text. And the New Bible movement, they use fake science. They claim that they have scientific proof that these manuscripts are the most ancient and reliable and this kind of thing. But it's fake science. It's not real science. And that's kind of what's going on with a lot of the global warming assertions that are being made. They're based upon claims that are quite often provably wrong. Now, we heard when Leonard Nimoy was on the History Channel, we heard what he said. He's saying, well, the scientists agree the ice is coming back. It's getting colder in the Antarctic. The ice is increasing. Now, Leonardo DiCaprio is saying, no, now the scientists know it's a fact that it's going the other way. You have, here's an article, before I get to the other one, called Climate Alarm, Failed Prognostications by the Institute for Energy Research. And it has a section called Now or Never Exaggerations, talking about Al Gore in his movie An Inconvenient Truth, that Al Gore prophesied that unless the world dramatically reduced greenhouse gases, we would hit a point of no return. In his book review of Gore's effort, James Hansen unequivocally stated, quote, we have at most 10 years, not 10 years to decide upon action, but 10 years to alter fundamentally the trajectory of global greenhouse emissions. Okay, so 10 years, this is back in about 2006. So that would take us to 2016. Here we are reaching the end of 2019. And obviously, they were wrong. So the article says, time is up on Gore's point of no return and Hansen's critical tipping point, etc. And the article goes on to talk about other claims that have been made. For example, back in the late 1980s, it says, the UN claimed that if global warming were not checked by the year 2000, rising sea levels would wash entire countries away. That should have happened 19 years ago. Did not happen. Then you have in 2009, then British Prime Minister Gordon Brown predicted that the world had only 50 days to save the planet from global warming. But 50 days, 6 months, and 8 years later, the Earth seems fine. That's the article. So now they're talking about the Democratic Party using the same platform, saying that what we're in now is the equivalent of World War III. And this is why it's important to look at the history of this whole environmental, I call it the environmental hoax or the environmental scam. It's like having con artists come out and they're hucksters and they're trying to sell you on something that is provably untrue. Now we have another article on the 18 spectacularly wrong predictions that were made back in the year 1970. And we're not going to be able to get to all of them, but I wanted to go over a few of the highlights, the more powerful ones. Back in 1970, Harvard biologist George Wald estimated that, quote, civilization will end within 15 or 30 years unless immediate action is taken against problems facing mankind, meaning environmental problems. This is on Earth Day, the first Earth Day, when they did an Earth Day. Back in 1970, around that same time, we have another quote from Paul Ehrlich, quote, population will inevitably and completely outstrip whatever small increases in food supplies we make, Ehrlich confidently declared in the April 1970 issue of Mademoiselle. He said, quote, the death rate will increase until at least 100 to 200 million people per year will be starving to death during the next 10 years. This is in 1970. 100 to 200 million people starving to death from 1970 to 1980. No, that did not happen. Mr. Ehrlich also went on to say that between 1980 and 1989, he said some 4 billion people, including 65 million Americans, would perish in the Great Die-Off, he called it. The quote, the Great Die-Off. 4 billion people, that's like most of the people on the planet. It did not happen. Obviously did not happen. But this kind of ridiculous, absurd, over-the-top alarmism, this is nothing new. This has been going on for decades, folks. And what does the Bible tell us? The Bible tells us that as time goes on, evildoers and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But we're also told to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather to expose them. And that's what we're doing today. We're trying to make sure that our audience is equipped to confront all of this climate hoax propaganda that's out there, because it's being employed at the highest levels of government, mass media, the news, etc. This is like an information onslaught, really a misinformation onslaught. All right, but we are out of time. That is going to do it for us today. That's our show. We'll stop it there. But we will be back next time as the Lord. You'll be Wallace in 1 John 5:7. This is a show I am compelled to do, having stumbled across a video here recently from Dr. Daniel B. Wallace, who, of course, we've talked about in the past through all of the issues that came up years ago over Codex Sinaiticus and the critical text, and our History of the Bible series with Tares Among the Wheat, and then the debate that we had with Dr. James White. And then in the midst of all of that, there was a presentation that was given by Dr. Dan Wallace. And one of our listeners had sent him an email asking him about our film, Tares Among the Wheat. And he said that he had not seen it, but he was aware of it. And that apparently we were the people he was referring to in his presentation when he said some people are trying to bring back this story of Simonides, etc., and to question the authenticity of Codex Sinaiticus. Well, as I've said before, there's been about 4 books that have been written now since that whole controversy went on by other researchers and scholars and so on, all of whom so far, at least 4 books, in 4 books, there's another book that was written where it seems like the author is making reference to the things that we investigated, but of course he does not agree with us. He's a critical text guy. But there's at least 4 authors who do agree that very likely the Codex Sinaiticus is a 19th century creation and is not really an ancient 4th century manuscript. It's not really the world's oldest Bible. It's also very likely that the other manuscript, really the main manuscript, the Codex Vaticanus, is very, very likely that Vaticanus is in fact a 15th century creation that was either created or it was somehow or other conjured up, possibly from an older text. That's still, to me, I have to admit, a mystery. But there's no historic evidence for Vaticanus outside the 15th century. And that's according to Professor J. Neville Birdsall, who was a paleographer. He passed away back in the early part of the 21st century. But Birdsall worked with people like Dr. Bruce Metzger, worked with the British Library. You can read his testimony. He was considered an expert on the Codex Vaticanus, and he was a paleographer. And we're getting ready to go back up to Canada here in October in a few weeks, and to give some more presentations on the Bible up there. I'm going to be giving a presentation on paleography in particular, because in order to understand the issues surrounding the critical text and what's really going on when they tell you about the more ancient, reliable manuscripts, You have to understand paleography, because that's what it comes down to. And as I show in Bridge to Babylon, paleography was the creation of Rome. Rome created paleography, apparently for the purpose of taking control of the idea of determining what is and what is not a genuine manuscript, that they would be the ones to control that whole process of determining the true from the false. And then once you realize what the grand conclusion is of the paleographers, that the Vatican's Greek Bible, Codex Vaticanus, is the number one Bible in the world. And that's according to the interpretation of Dean John Bergen in the 19th century when he evaluated the Westcott and Hort theory, which is where, you know, all of this came together. But we go over that in Bridge to Babylon. Anyway, so all of that to say, let's hear from Dr. Daniel B. Wallace. Now, he's giving a presentation, and he's answering a question about the difference between the King James Bible and modern translations. And here's what he says.
Yeah, I'll be happy to do that. This is a great question to end the whole thing with, actually. The question is, the King James Bible, produced in 1611, the New Testament was based on half a dozen Greek New Testament manuscripts. What are our modern translations based on today, and what are some of the differences between the two? Well, the King James Bible was based on six manuscripts no earlier than the 12th century, and it was produced at the beginning of the 17th century, so they go back 500 years. Today, we have nearly 6,000 Greek manuscripts, so almost 1,000 times as many manuscripts as they had in the King James day. And we have manuscripts that don't go back just to the 12th century, but all the way back to the 2nd century. So our basis is much earlier, and it's much stronger.
So welcome to the wonderful world of critical text sophistry, because that's what you're listening to here, in my opinion, with Dr. Daniel B. Wallace. So notice, he's answering a question about the King James Bible and what are our modern Bibles based on and whatnot. So he starts out by telling the audience that the King James was allegedly based on six Greek manuscripts. Okay, that's the first part. Six Greek manuscripts, that's the basis. But from 1611 to the present day, now we have over 6,000 manuscripts. And they don't just go back to the 12th century, they go back to the 2nd century. Now, he doesn't go into any details about the quality of the manuscripts that he's describing. And he omits some very important details. For example, the vast majority of the 6,000 manuscripts that have been discovered from then till now are in agreement with the readings of the received text, and therefore the readings of the authorized version, the King James Bible. 95% of those 6,000 actually agree with the King James translation, but he doesn't tell them that. What he does, he gives them the impression that the modern Bibles are based on 6,000 manuscripts and all of this earlier evidence and all this other kind of stuff, which is very, very deceptive and provably untrue. The reality is that the modern Bibles are based primarily on two manuscripts, Vaticanus and Sinaiticus, and then they sprinkle in some of the papyri here and there, P66, P75, and others, a total of about 45 documents that they employ. Okay, out of this 6,000, they're not using 6,000. They're using 45. And they don't want to talk about where those 45 actually came from. They don't want to talk about that. They don't want to talk about the history of Vaticanus, the real history, and the fact that it was rejected by Desiderius Erasmus because Erasmus believed it was a forgery, or it was a manuscript that had been tampered with at the Council of Florence. And that's documented. The Council of Florence went on back in the 1430s, and Vaticanus shows up in 1475. And so that's something that typically they will not discuss. That's usually avoided. Now, there are some who discuss it. You have a professor, Conrad Martin Hyde. Conrad Martin Hyde, who's written a book on this. The book is in German. I've not yet been able to find an English translation, but he talks about the issue. It is detailed and complex. I should say he is a critical text adherent. So Dr. Hyde, he actually agrees with a critical text, but nevertheless, he acknowledges that Erasmus believed that Vaticanus was a corrupted codex right from the beginning. As soon as there's any mention of it here, within, let's see, 1475, and Erasmus is doing his work after 1516 to 15 into the 1530s. So within the first 50 years of the recorded history of Vaticanus, here you've got probably the greatest scholar of his generation, and really one of the greatest scholars in the whole history of academia, Desiderius Erasmus, if you study him. He's highly, highly revered in his hometown of Anderlecht even today. But Erasmus believed, based upon a rumor that he had heard, and he admitted it was a rumor, that Vaticanus was a corruption, that it had been deliberately corrupted somehow or other at the Council of Florence earlier in the 15th century. Now, you combine that with the fact that there's no history of the manuscript outside the 15th century, no documented history anywhere, according to the leading experts. And the only thing that you have that supports the idea that it's somehow or other from the 4th century is paleography, the Roman Catholic system of paleography. And who was the first scholar that said it was from the 4th century? Johann Leonard Hug, J.L. Hug, in the year 1810, who was a Roman Catholic scholar and critic. J.L. Hug, the Catholic scholar, declared Vaticanus to be a 4th century codex, and then Tischendorf and the others, they went along with this. This is why people believe the Vatican is behind the New Bible movement. And of course, the scholars who have supported the New Bible movement, the chief guys like Dr. Bruce Metzger, Kurt Ahlund, even Tischendorf back in the 19th century, these are all people who took trips to the Vatican, often multiple trips to the Vatican. Philip Schaff, he's another one, would go to the Vatican, meet with the Pope, etc. And then they're all promoting this idea of getting away from the Protestant received text, which is what the received text really is. It's considered the Protestant scripture. All right, so Dr. Dan Wallace, in this presentation, he says that they've got 6,000 manuscripts. He doesn't give the details about them. And he's saying that they're earlier. They're not from the 12th century. They go back to the 2nd century, he says, all the way back there, as though that somehow or other means they're going to be more authoritative. And there's two arguments there. One, where Vaticanus and Sinaiticus are concerned, they have no way of proving that those go back to the 4th century. That's all based on paleography. Very important to understand. Vaticanus shows up in 1475. Codex Sinaiticus, the first pages appear in 1844. The balance of it shows up in 1859. As we showed you in Tares Among the Wheat, you had a Greek paleographer, Constantine Simonides, spent 4 years arguing that he was the real creator of Codex Sinaiticus back in 1840, that it is a 19th century creation. James Farrar in 1907, in his book Literary Forgeries, calls it an unsolved mystery of literature. Now see, footnotes like that are what should be in these modern Bibles. I mean, if they really wanted to do what they claim they were trying to do, is just to tell the truth about the evidence. Oh, we have to tell the truth about all the variants because of our scholarly integrity. Okay, well, that's fine. Just, you know, but tell the whole truth. Don't edit information the way that they're doing. You see, they're not telling people, hey, wait a minute, this manuscript that we're calling the world's oldest Bible? Yeah, this guy spent 4 years claiming that he was the real author, And the information was examined by a British barrister who came to the conclusion that the matter was never fully resolved in 1907. And that's one of the manuscripts that they're telling you is the oldest and most reliable. But see, they don't want to include that footnote. They want you to doubt the various verses of the text of Scripture. They don't want you to doubt their scholarly abilities at drawing conclusions and determining what is or what is not an ancient and reliable manuscript. That's what they don't want you to question. They want you to question the Word of God. They don't want you to question them. That's the problem that I have with what they do and how they present their information. Okay, let's go to our commercial break. We will talk more when we come back into some audio from Dr. Wallace answering a question about the King James Bible and the difference between the King James versus the modern Bibles. Now, remember, one thing that I think is very important to always remember about Daniel B. Wallace is his ultimate view of the Scripture, which you can find in his online article, which is called 15 Myths About Bible Translation. 15 Myths About Bible Translation, where he says in myth number 14, if you look it up, he openly says that the myth is that, and here I'm going to look it up and I'm going to read it to you. The myth is that, quote, red letter editions of the Bible highlight the exact words of Jesus. That's the myth, according to Dr. Wallace. He says, quote, scholars are not sure of the exact words of Jesus. Ancient historians were concerned to get the gist of what someone said, but not necessarily the exact wording. And he goes on. He concludes by saying, quote, in truth, though red letter editions of the Bible may give comfort to believers that they have the very words of Jesus in every instance, this is a false comfort. End quote. Daniel B. Wallace, 15 Myths About Bible Translation. So let's understand, he's not talking about English Bibles. He's talking about the Greek originals. That the ancient historians, by which he can only mean the apostles, now who are called historians rather than divinely inspired witnesses of the truth, and they were concerned with just getting the gist of what was being said, not necessarily the exact wording. That completely undermines the credibility of the Bible. It really does, if you think about it. And it parallels what Dan Wallace is saying here, is a parallel of what the current Jesuit, the Marxist Jesuit general, Arturo Sosa, what he has said. There's that article on Breitbart where they quote the Jesuit superior general, quote, we don't know what Jesus really said. And if you want to understand how it is that the modern Jesuit general agrees with somebody who's considered a conservative evangelical defender of the Greek New Testament, etc., how is it that they came to the same conclusion? You watch our series on the history of the Bible, and we show you Tischendorf and the other scholars interacting with Rome, interacting with the Vatican. This is how they've come to the same conclusion, because they have embraced the same theory. And if you embrace the critical text theory, the conclusion that you will come to ultimately, if you follow it to its logical end, is, well, no Bible can really be the inspired and errant Word of God, because the most ancient witnesses are a collection of contradictions. That's the problem. And where the papyri are concerned, they don't tell you that those papyri were found near a Gnostic library and are very likely of Gnostic origin. I mean, that's the circumstantial evidence points in that direction. And again, we talk about that in Bridge to Babylon. But here, now I want to get to Dr. Wallace talking about 1 John 5:7. For Dan Wallace and James White, they think this is the smoking gun against the King James and the received text. So listen to this description.
No, in the NIV, what you have here is, for there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and the three are in agreement. So it's quite different, and that's in 1 John 5:7. And then there is no 1 John 5:8 in this translation, because that was a verse, this verse that's in the King James Bible, that the NIV editors did not have. And here's why. That verse in the King James seems to be the strongest affirmation of the Trinity we have in the Bible. And yet, it was not part of the original text of the New Testament. Now, the early church examined the New Testament and came to the belief of the Trinity entirely apart from this verse. But here's how this verse got into the Bible. Erasmus publishes his first text in 1516, his second Greek New Testament in 1519, and by that time there were lots of Roman Catholic authorities who were saying, wait a minute, this is a problem. You don't have the verse in 1 John 5:7 that is the Trinitarian formula.
Okay, so he says lots of Roman Catholic authorities. He's trying to make it appear as if 1 John 5:7 is a Catholic rendering, you know, a Roman Catholic rendering or something like that, when at that point the Reformation had not really happened. There was not a distinct difference between Catholics and Protestants. That distinction would not be made for years to come. Where you would have Protestantism that would be developed as something separate from Rome entirely. Certainly there were problems that happened prior to that, going back to Wycliffe, but to say Roman Catholic authorities as though, wow, this is a Roman Catholic thing, it's not a Protestant thing, is very misleading. You have to remember, the King James Bible is seen as the Protestant scriptures. All right, let's listen.
And he said, I didn't put it in, because I could not find any manuscripts that had it. So in 1520, there was a scribe who was working at Oxford University who transcribed the entire Greek New Testament as a handwritten manuscript. His name was Roy, by the way. And then that manuscript somehow ended up at the doorstep of Erasmus in Basel, Switzerland, where he was working. And so this new manuscript that he just, was left on his doorstep had the Trinitarian formula in 1 John 5:7, because that scribe named Roy put it in. He translated some late manuscripts into back into Greek. And to this day, we have 8 manuscripts that have that Trinitarian formula in them, but they're all from the 16th century or later. So it doesn't look like it goes back to the original. Well, in Erasmus's third edition, he put it in, because he said, I didn't put it in because I couldn't find any manuscripts. And so he finds a manuscript, so therefore he puts it in his text. And that's why in the King James and in English-speaking Bibles, we've had this history of this Trinitarian formula.
All right, so there again, what you're hearing is more critical text sophistry. What he does not reveal, I mean, he tries to make it out like the only reason Erasmus put the verse there was because some manuscript showed up suddenly. And their typical argument is that they think that the manuscript was either a forgery or was created by this guy, even though that's not necessarily provable. There are about 8 manuscripts that contain 1 John 5:7, 8 Greek manuscripts. But then you have many, many thousands of Latin manuscripts and other manuscripts that contain the verse. Furthermore, there is a great article that you can find at Chick Publications on 1 John 5:7, where David Daniels does a great job tracing the verse historically among the writings of early church fathers all the way back to 200 AD, where Tertullian made reference to it. In 250, you have Cyprian of Carthage made reference to it. 350 AD, Priscillian referred to it. Throughout the 4th century, you have many references to it, multiple references to it. And really, throughout church history, it is referenced. The reason they're misleading is because they're not giving the full history of the verse. Now, David Daniels, I think, gives a very plausible explanation for why the verse would have been left out of many other Greek manuscripts because he says, quote, the Greek Eastern Orthodox religion was combating a heresy called Sabellianism and would have found it easier to combat the heresy by simply removing the troubling passage from their Bibles. Sabellianism is the idea that essentially denies that you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, that these are three distinct persons of God. And so it's believed that this may very well have been why the passage was removed from some Greek manuscripts, or really even most of them, but yet you find it in others. Of course, as we know, you don't really need that verse to prove Trinitarian doctrine. You've got plenty of other verses that make reference to the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. So that's the reason it is generally thought that the verse may have been removed from certain manuscripts and not from others. And yet, we find a trail of evidence going back to the early centuries among early church writers. All right, brethren, we are out of time. That's going to do it for us today. That is our show. We'll stop it there, but we will be back.